is the daughter of late Mr. Shashi Kapoor and late Jennifer Kendall. She is the co-founder and the director of Sanjna Spearheads, the art at Play for Schools program, loves the sheer energy and excitement of the arts and is brilliant at curating this for eager audiences. She initiated the creation of the Indian Theatre Forum because she was feeling lonely and is currently part of the core team as well as the core team member and the facilitator for SMART, that is, Strategic Management in the Art of Theatre. Many of you will remember of her building Prithvi Theatre into a warm, inviting cultural hub. Some of you will remember her for an earnest Amul India show, Questioning, and some of you apparently love them in Hero Hiralal. A confession which nano feels will impress her. She believes in multitasking and will one day possibly achieve being in multiple places at once, so that she can always be with theater and always be with herself at once. And at the same time, when you don't find her messing up about with the art, you will probably found it in the jungles of Africa or scuba diving in some beautiful ocean somewhere, talking to the mantis. And we have a great round of applause for such a great personality. Now welcome Mrs. Sanjna Kapoor to share her experience and have some great conversation with us.
No, I'll come back. I want to stand because, you know, I am very selfish and greedy. So when I know that for some years now this university has tried to bring me to meet you, and I've never been able to come, and this time I said yes, and I'm greedy because I want to meet you. And I really infect you if you're not already infected with a deep love and curiosity and desire for the arts. And I hope that you will want to carry the arts with you into your lives as you grow up. And that is my ambition. But I need you guys to sit down. Come and sit here now. Why are you standing? You're punished. So come and sit yahan pe na, seat par baithe na. Nick? आप खड़े नहीं हो सकते हो पीछे के लोग का ब्लॉक कर रहे हो प्लीज कम 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 सीट हियर ऑन द स्टेप आर यू लीविंग आप जा रहे हो बस यहीं पे बैठे कैमरा के पहले सामने यहाँ पे एक सीट है I'm sorry, it's very distracting having you, very scary. Somebody can sit on this chair. This is my dear friend, Shambhaji. And he's a wonderful, wonderful artist in his own right. And many things. Maharashtra and local poet, singer, person, and I'm delighted that he's here. And you know why I'm here? Why have I come to Bikaner? And I hope you will be there. I hope I'll see some of you there. Wonderful. Yes, they're volunteers. Yes, yes. So that is fantastic, and it's a great opportunity to learn how to manage, those of you who are doing management, to volunteer. People used to come and volunteer at the Prithvi Festival, and it's a great learning experience. So I suggest you try and volunteer next year. But you go and see the shows and watch everything. And also, be critical. Don't just watch it and be like, wow, you have a great NA. Think about what it made you feel, what it made you think, and whether it worked, and whether it didn't work. So, I tell me how long do you have?
No. No, you've got classes.
So I'm going to talk for a little while and then we can have a conversation. And maybe we can bring Chambaji into the conversation because there are lots of things to talk about. It's very exciting. But I'm not going to talk about cinema, okay? So if you come to hear that, then you can go because it's not going to be fun. I'm going to talk about theatre. And I'll tell you why, because yes, I did one film, but I did one in a bit, many films, little bits of three films, but I did Hiralal, and for me, actually, that was a big learning for me. I realized that it's not enough to come from this family where you are surrounded by film and performers and this mahal, but you have to also know the tools of how to work. And I had not gone to school, drama school. I had not done any training. My parents learned by doing. So they performed, like most people do. By doing, kaam karte, you learn. But in this world, things become a little ulta, na? You become the heroine before you actually work your way up to becoming the heroine. So I got this film, and I thought I would get help and I'd be able to know what to do, and I realized I was horrible. I hated that film for me. I hated myself in that film as an actor. And I went to drama school after that film.
Oh.
No. So for me, that was a great example of what a failure, personal failure can do. And I think there is no such thing as a personal failure. I think it's just a great learning opportunity. And the trouble with our education today is that it doesn't allow you to fail. And it's really important. It's a slap in your face. Very gentle, kind, good slap. But it's a firm slap in your face. And there's nothing wrong with it. And we should not be fearful of it. Because if you are fearful of it, you will never be brave. And you will never take risks. And you will never do anything you can't do. And my son, who's 16, said exactly this. He's taken theater in school. And he said, no, Mom, I don't want to do that. Because what if I don't know? What if I'm bad at it? And I said, buddy, can you say that? You haven't even tried. And the whole idea is that you create a mahal around you that you know that you can do as good as you can do. Right? So, what is it that makes me love theater so much? When I went to drama school and I went to New York after Hero Hiralal, I was 19. Or I was, 20. I did Hero Hiralal when I was 18. And I realized that, oh my God, I love theater. I love the process of rehearsal. I love that safe space where you can take risks and you can try silly things and you can fail, and it's with people that you grow to really love and work with. And then you go out into that performance area, and that is really scary but wonderful because you reach out to absolute strangers and try and convey meaning to them. And this conveying meaning is what art is all about. And that is what is so exciting, whether it's a poem or whether it's a song or whether it's a play or a film or a novel, it conveys meaning to you and you and you and you and you and you. And each one of you go away with your own individual also interpretation of that meaning. And that is beautiful. That richness is what I love. Tell me, what do you think is the difference? Don't tell me the difference of what happened, the process. Tell me the difference from your perspective of being an audience, from watching a play or watching a film. What is the difference for you as an audience when you watch a film and when you watch a play? Aapne play dekha hoga na? Then what is the difference to you? What is your concept? What is your idea of the difference between theatre, live, and your parda mein hota hai, cinema? What is more realistic? Theatre is more realistic. How?
I am a king, I say.
How can I be realistic? I'm not a king and mera kuch nahi hai, ya mahal, mara kuch nahi hai. How could you be more realistic?
Compared to movie.
But movie pe aap wo pura mera palace dekhenge aur mera mukut aur mera sona and you'll see everything. That's more realistic, no?
Provoking your, go further into trying to understand what you're saying because it's right, but I want you to articulate it more. How is it more realistic? What does realistic mean?
Emotions.
No, that I know. There are, you don't, I'm not talking about the technique from here. I'm talking about your experience as a darshak.
The identity and relate with these factors. Emotions.
In cinema, you cry, you laugh, you get scared. Why? Differently. Same, same. Emotion is same, same. What is the difference? What is the difference that you feel if it is really a wonderful thing?
Enjoy that part, do you feel the real sense of that? In comparison to the movie, we have a certain kind of communication and all, but in that particular way, the artist is going to perform at a stage in connectivity with the people, like that is the body body.
So when you're saying it's real, it is happening really in front of you. There are live people on stage. Why do we love the circus? I love the circus. I love the circus. My father used to take me to the circus every year on my birthday. One of my greatest gifts he would give me.
And you love the circus also because it's live and it's pushing human effort and endeavor to an extreme. And also there is that terrible human nature of ours where we think that something can go wrong. And nothing goes wrong, hopefully. And it's magic. It's magic. But also the fact that it is real is because it's not realistic, it is forcing you to imagine. So theater mein jab ya murder होने वाला है या गरीब आदमी है या there's a wonderful queen or whoever, you are imagining the scenario, you are participating in that, you're making it come alive and you're making meaning yourself. तो वो participation बहुत है and you know something very important theatre में जो कि actually universities must also learn, ये seats पे आप जो बैठे हैं ना कुर्सी ये सिनेमा के सीट्स है क्यों सो सकते हो आप ये यू आर बीइंग शोन एग्जैक्टली व्हाट द डायरेक्टर वांट्स यू टू सी मंडे पे आई वांट यू टू सी माय नोज तो पूरा जूमिंग होगा मेरा का नाक पे ओके एंड माय नोज नॉस्ट्रल्स विल फ्लेयर एंड यू से हाउ शी इज गोइंग टू क्राई और सम नॉनसेंस But theater में I can't do that. थोड़ा कुछ spotlight कर सकती हूँ मैं पर उससे ज़्यादा you have to use your imagination. Whereas cinema में they're showing you everything. तो आप आराम से बैठ के it's much more passive. और एक दूसरी चीज़ है cinema के seats के which is a problem which is why I can't sit. It's a very high. उसके the back is very high. देखो आपका गर्दन तक यार not you can relax. Theater में seats always, I think also in colleges and schools, should be a little bit uncomfortable. You have to be alert. You have to be awake. Ab aaram se, if you can fall asleep, then you should go home. This is not the seat. So this is, architects need to know this about colleges and definitely about theatres. So, when I was little, to kahaniya are usually told to children sote waqt na fairy tales batate hain ya stories batate hain. I used to hear stories of Shakespeare. Or I used to hear stories of my grandparents' travels through India. Because both my grandparents, sab log bhul jate ki Prithviraj Kapoor aur Jeffrey Kendall, dono unke khud ke traveling theatre companies the. And you can imagine 1944, India. You know what was going on. Prithviraj Kapoor, many years before, had come from Peshawar with a hockey stick. I don't know why.
with a hockey stick, 50 rupees that his auntie had given him, and a dream. And he came to Bombay to become an actor. And wo railway station se utar ke Victoria mein wo ghoda gaadi mein baith ke samudra ke kinare pe gaya tha. Peshawar, he never seen the sea. Samudra kabhi dekha nahi. And he looked at the sea and he said, if I don't become Hindi man, beautiful Hindi man, my Hindi is terrible. If I don't become an actor here, I'm going to go to Hollywood. When we're young, we have wonderful dreams, and it's great, wonderfully exciting. But luckily, when the first day I went to the studio, studios used to make their own films. Every studio had their own label. It's like MGM, you know, we know Metro Goldwyn and whatever. Walt Disney and all that. Yahan pe bhi tha. And wahan pe, you couldn't just go in. You couldn't make an appointment. You didn't even know anybody. And the darwan, the watchman, was from Peshawar. Kismat. And they spoke in Pashto together and he let him in. Then one more piece of kismat. He went in and he was big. He was a bodybuilder in college. And he was also an actor. He used to act in college. He was studying law. But he started doing theatre in college and he loved it. And so his professor said, Jao, go and be an actor. This law of college. That day, the film star, the big actor of that show, he was standing in line. He got to stand in line. Extras for the film would stand in line and they would be given a role. So he was standing in line. He was very beautiful. So that was also lucky. So that day the main star came late and the director was so angry he sacked him. And my grandfather got the role. So that is the thing. My great, if I was not doing theatre, which I love with a passion, my great other passion is education, not higher education, because I don't know much about that, and I think that is, I think lower schools, because I love working with children and I love the idea of what good education can do, and I hate the idea of what bad education can do. And one of my heroes, and I read a lot of books about it because I'm fascinated with inspirational stories about teachers and principals and good schools. There is a man called Ken Robinson, who is my hero, and he talks about, everybody talks now today about creativity, and how you know that how even whether you're going to be a manager or a businessman or a scientist or anything, you need creativity, and it's not a big mantra in the world. Education mein creativity aana hai. Isliye actually it's good for us because log थिएटर की तरफ देखते हैं सोचे कि हम थिएटर ले आएंगे तो क्रिएटिविटी टाइम आ जाएगा बच्चों में. सो आई डोंट माइंड दैट. आई एम ट्रैवलिंग एंड टेकिंग थिएटर अक्रॉस द कंट्री. बट केन रॉबिन्सन्स डेफिनेशन ऑफ क्रिएटिविटी आई लव. ही सेज क्रिएटिविटी इज अ प्रोसेस ऑफ कमिंग अप विद न्यू आइडियाज दैट आर ऑफ वैल्यू टू अदर पीपल.
वाह.
एंड इट्स ब्यूटीफुल. And they, usually he says it should be original, but it can be original to you. She can think of the same idea, you can think of the same idea. It doesn't matter, but it has to be an original idea for you. And of course, the core of this is imagination. And then how do we ignite imagination? And I think that's what education should be all about. Right? So anyway, he has a beautiful book, if you're interested, called The Element, and you should read that. But coming back to my story, so 1944, Prithvi Kapoor is a big actor, well-known actor. He's one of the few actors, maybe in the world, who was a big actor in silent black and white movies. And he made a transition to talkies and to color. And he made that transition to all the changes in cinema. But his passion was still theater. So in 1944, at the peak of his film career, he created Prithvi Theatres, S ke saath, jo ki unka theater company tha. 150 log thi usme, bade bade sets the usme. He was mad. And he traveled, we can add, I think. and it was mashhoor kahani hai dikhane ka. He performed at the Ganga Theatre. Ganga Theatre, you know this story. He performed in Ganga Theatre and he loved it. Ganga Theatre ke andar aap kabhi gaye hain?
Yes, ma'am.
It's so beautiful. And it's a beautiful theatre. It's a perfect theatre for performance. Aajkal to kuch. Unfortunately, there's a legal case going on. I hope they renovate it and it comes alive again. But unhone kaha show karne ke baad ki, I wish I could put this theatre on wheels and take it with me across India because it is such a beautiful theatre. 1944, India. And he knew, he felt ki cinema ek cheez hoti hai, but theatre se main logo tak pahunch sakta hoon. And I can really touch them and transform them and share my ideas. So his plays were all socially connected stories about farmers, about money, about the wall before partition. He talked about a play about the wall, Diwar. He talked about art. What is the role of art in the new India that we're going to have? He talked about all these urgent issues that he felt. And art natak hi kiye unhone. And 16 saal tak he traveled across the country. At the same time, the Second World War had just come to an end. My British grandfather did not want to go to war. He was a pacifist. He did not believe picking up a gun and killing another person was being patriotic in his mind. But he wanted to serve the country. So us waqt he could join something called Entertainment for the Troops. And my grandparents, actors, both of them, my grandmother and my grandfather, time for the British troops in India, in Southeast Asia, pura ghum ghaam ke wapas chale gaye. The war ended, depression hua, England mein, you can imagine, kuch kaam hi nahi tha, horrible. Anyway, my grandmother didn't really like pura the weather in England, grey, wet, dripping, rainy, sab udaas log, and he had fallen in love with India. So he got 14 actors together and he got one show, only one show, Madman. And 2 weeks they took to come in a boat, a ship from England to India, and they stayed for 40 years. And they also traveled from north to south, to east to west, across India by road, by train, by Prithvi Kapoor used to go third class, in the third class, two bogi bhar ke unke log ke saath, they would all keep together or travel together, koi stargiri nahi tha. That was, these are the stories I grew up with. I grew up listening to these adventures. Theatre was their life. And so it infected me. Viral ban gaya. And I wanted to become viral to you also. But I realized when I school gayi thi, drama school gayi thi in New York, this is my love, not cinema. So I came back to Bombay and started very slowly and with great fear working at Prithvi after some years. Fear kyun? Because it was a huge responsibility and I've never believed in it is my right. I don't think it's my right. I don't think you inherit a right. For me personally, I don't believe in that kind of legacy. I don't believe that if I, you know, it just has to automatically come to me. I have to earn it. So I had some ideas, some plans, and I would talk a lot with my father. And he was wonderful. He was a wonderful inspiration for me. And Zora Segal, who was an actress, who worked with Prithvi Raj Kapoor, she asked him, she said, आप ये नाम क्यों रखा पृथ्वी थिएटर्स सर का मतलब क्या एक ही तो कंपनी है तो ही सेड कि आई ड्रीम दैट देयर विल बी मेनी 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 पृथ्वी थिएटर्स अक्रॉस इंडिया एंड ही वाज अ नॉमिनेटेड रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ऑफ द कंट्री ट्वाइस इन पार्लियामेंट प्रेसिडेंट्स नॉमिनी इन द 50s 1950s में और उनके जो आर्काइव्स थे एक वन ईयर वी वर सेलिब्रेटिंग 100 इयर्स ऑफ हिज बर्थ एंड वी वर डूइंग रिसर्च ऑन पृथ्वीराज कपूर थिएटर लाइफ एंड आर्काइव्स फ्रॉम द आर्काइव्स वी गॉट स्टोरी उन्होंने कहा पार्लियामेंट एंड ही सेड समथिंग ब्यूटीफुल वंस He said that when we're building India, you know, in those days, Nehru's whole mantra was temples of India are our dams and our, you know, but that's the temples of India. So Prithviraj Kapoor ne kaha ki, actually, our temples of India should be our theatres. Because in a theatre, you don't ask, ki aap Musalman ho, aap Dalit ho, aap Isai ho, aap kaun ho. You sit in an audience with a big stage. Your brain gets ignited with a new idea. Your heart gets moved by an emotion. And you come out slightly shifted, slightly changed. And that is the transformational power of theatre. And he said this in Parliament. Nobody listened to him. But, you know, so I think that that is, these are the things that I got infected by. And for me, my deep, deep, deep sadness is, even today, that I worked 21 years at Prithvi Theatre, but there are no more Prithvi Theatres. And I wish that we could have Prithvi. Prithvi is like a Mecca, jahan sab logo dana hai wahan pe ek to baar Irish coffee peene ya natak dekhne. Natak shayad dekhenge, but cafe mein baith ke, this has now become the Mecca for audiences, but it's also the Mecca for performers. But why has it not been imitated 1,000 times across this wonderful country of ours? And I haven't really understood the answer. I think there are two reasons. One is the financial model, which is not very viable. It's on prime property. Crazy father of mine. He could have made so much money, more money. And it sucks money up because it is so small, so seat. And it is subsidizing theatre. So jo log kaam karte hain, jo shows karte hain, they pay for the actual cost of the theatre. Otherwise, they will not survive. So it's a tough proposition, but it's possible. I believe today is possible. Second thing is, it's a lot of hard work. It's really tough. Yeh nahi ki, you know, oh, it's so easy. Mera baap ka theatre hai, main toh kuch bhi kar sakti hoon. It's not like that. Of course. I am very, 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 very fortunate. I can knock on a door and I can get an appointment and I can meet people and I can be invited to talk to you, and it's a privilege. But it's a huge responsibility. And I take it very seriously, and I really, really hope that at least in my lifetime there are another, what, 50 Prithvis across the country. So let's see. Not me. I don't want to run them. I don't want to make them, but I want to ignite them. I want to be a catalyst. So I think being a catalyst is really, really important. So I'm really happy to be here at Nair because of this dream. Because Sudesh Vyas, another wonderful crazy, and I love my world because it's full of crazy people. This wonderful crazy man here, Shambhaji. And it's these wonderful crazy, and I use crazy with deep respect and adulation. And I think it's a huge value because you have to be slightly mad. You know, you're not doing the regular thing of getting a job and caring about what's happening in your family. Like, of course you care about that, of course you care about your job. But you also care about the larger world, the society around you. And I hope that's what you actually get from your education. I hope that that consciousness is what you go away with. Is that you all have a role to play in society. Not an actor, but you all have a role to play. And that's really valuable. We met this wonderful, wonderful writer yesterday. What's his name? I'm so bad with names. Nandakishore, and he said the same thing. He said democracy is not really a right, it's a responsibility. So you live in a democracy today, a democracy that all those people so many years ago set up for you. And it's your responsibility now to contribute to it and to make it vibrant. And to understand what that means, what does a democracy mean? So it's really, really exciting, I think. But I'm going to stop talking because I can go on and on and on. And I'm going to ask you to ask me questions or to tell me about any ideas that you have that would be interesting to share. Actually, I'll ask you a question. So I say this a lot in schools when I meet school children, especially school children, because that, especially older ones, 9th, 10th standard. You have a passion. Yeah, it can be anything. What is it? Share. Don't be shy. You have nodded your head over there. But also, you're shy to speak. What can it be? It can be anything, I promise you. A passion about pets, pet dogs, or music, or I don't know, nail polish. But anything, do you have a passion? Have you found your passion? Because actually, I'm going to just say that Ken Robinson, in his book, The Element, he talks about that. He says, the element, and he calls it the element, is something that is there in everybody. Everybody, all of us. We have an element, which is our passion. And actually, what education should do is let you find your element. But unfortunately, it doesn't. It wants to make you uniform like everybody else. It wants to leave you just one kind of color so that it's easy to measure you and to map you and to grade you. You know? And that's not who you are. You are that, but you are so much more. You are this incredibly unique person with unique tastes and ideas and smells and beauties. So for you to find your passion is really important because it's what makes you feel alive at your 100%. And if you don't allow that to come alive, then you're going to go through life like it's a drudgery, you know? It's going to be tough. You can go through life doing a job that you don't really like. That's okay. But you have your passion with you. And then it just makes it more alive. You're very lucky if what you're passionate about is also your life job, which I'm lucky. I'm really lucky. So he says that finding your passion is an important thing. This is Ken Robinson. He says finding your tribe is important. After you find Ketan, I like dancing. So let me find people who like dancing and find reaching out to them and connecting them, which is why I connect. Which is why I'm in Bikaner. I'm finding my tribe of Sudesh Vyas, or I'm finding my tribe of somebody. I join the dots and need to find these people because they inspire me. And you need inspiration. They don't have to be in the same city, they can be across the world. But find those people. A young boy in school said that he likes making music videos and putting them up. And that's great. And he found friends, and all those kids in his class laughed when he said that. They laughed at him. And I urged him to continue talking, and he continued talking, and then I realized that he was okay. He had found his tribe. You know, luckily, thanks to this World Wide Web, he found people who appreciated him. But in school, he was a bit hardcasing. So they couldn't really interact with him, which was a shame. It was really sad. Don't worry about being that person. It's not a problem. So he said you find your tribe, and he said the third thing is really important. Keep yourself open to chance, to serendipity. You know that word serendipity? It's another wonderful word. Not exactly kismet, huh? Kismet is slightly more loaded, but yeah, I use that a lot. I said that. My father used to say that. But chance. If you're closed, then it won't come to you. But if you're open, and there's a sign, there's an experiment that happened in America. Psychologists or psychiatrists were doing this experiment. They had a group of people like you, that group, were all negative, pessimistic, miserable. The world was coming to an end, gloom, doom. And there was this group of people who just by their nature were optimistic, positive, had a better outlook to the world. The experiment was simple. All of them at different times had to go into a cafe, a barista, do we have, have a coffee, and come up and go to work. Outside the barista,
on the floor on the road was a $100 bill. 80% of them didn't see it. And 80% of them saw it. And that's what he means. Being open to good chance, to good luck coming your way. And I think that's a very important thing. You have to be open to possibility and to anything happen. So tell me your passions.
Huh? I'm passionate about mountains.
About mountains? You like looking at them or climbing them?
Climbing them.
Oh. Wow. What does that make you feel when you get to the top? Or when you get on your way there?
No, I tried to scale a mountain easy on a peak, which is in Sikkim, but I failed to do that because of bad weather and lack of physical stamina. But I managed to climb up to 5,000 meters above the sea level, but that was amazing and horrible.
Made you feel really
physically sick.
There's no oxygen level. I was not physically fit to climb 6,000 meters
peak. But still, I managed to
go to the level
of 5,000
meters.
And that made me
more
motivated. It motivated me to climb for
the first time. I think it's fantastic. You know, I don't get mountains. I drop my fingers. It's my thing. And I so it's a, and I love, what's his name? Who climbed Mount Everest first? Hillary was asking him, why did you do it? He said, and I love it. But I love the fact that that's what it does. Everybody can have very unique, very different passions. And what it's done for her personally is it's really pushing her, transformed her. That's beautiful. And anybody else? Anybody else? You are not in YouTube, boys. You are not in video. Don't share. Okay. You can ask me questions then if you don't want to talk. Ask me questions, you want to say things. Sanjana.
Passion, I don't really have a passion, you can say, but you know, when we close our eyes and bandh karte hain raat ko, तो हम कुछ चीजें देखते हैं, कुछ चीजें हम इमेजिन करते हैं। तो ना मेरे पास एक 7 ड्रीम्स है, जब भी मैं आंखें बंद करता हूँ रात को साथ वो पूरी हो जाए और 24 आवर्स होते हैं मेरे पास, वो मैं कह नहीं पाता आपको पता है। तो मेरा पैशन है कि लाइफ में मतलब आई डोंट वांट टू डाई विद लाइक ड्रीम्स, आई वांट टू डाई विद मेमोरीज, यू नो। सो मेरा पैशन है कि मैं उन सारे ड्रीम्स को ना यहाँ से जाने से पहले उन सबको ना एक हासिल कर सकते वो पैशन है।
And these dreams are
reachable for all different people. So like, I'm kind of mad person, but still, they're amazing.
Ooh. Wow, that's beautiful. It's beautiful to be able to be that clear. Wow, and good perseverance, and good fortune, and good connections, and good everything. Wow.
Yeah,
I would ask you to tell us what they are. It's different from a bucket list, huh? People now are very famous for anything. I have a bucket list. Yeah, what I want to do, I want to, you know, go to Hawaii, and I want to go scuba diving, and I want to go and meet Bill Clinton or whatever. That's not a passion. That's a bucket list. But a passion is to actually achieve something, to do something yourself. Anybody want to ask a question? I'm going. Just share ideas. You can talk. It doesn't have to be a question. Yes.
Do we need any degree to be in theaters or any specialization is needed?
What creative field? Which creative?
Not in theater. Do we need any degree or we need some training on how we can?
So as I said, I am the most uneducated or non-educated person you know, possibly. I have done my 10th standard ICSE, for which I did not sit for my final exam because my mother was dying. She was 16 when I died. And I did my O levels, so that's equivalent.
so I've got my O level. So I am a 10th standard pass. I was never going to go and do 11th and 12th because 11th and 12th in Maharashtra and Bombay at that time was junior college and it was really bad. It's become slightly better now and now we have more schools that have 11th and 12th. But I did not want to go to college. I wanted to go to drama school. I was to go to drama school in the UK, but not in India. And my mother passed away and then lots of things. That didn't happen. And later I went to America to go to drama school. And I told you my example of how I felt I needed the tools. So the answer to your question is a plain no, you don't need a degree or anything. But you need to find ways of getting those tools. You can have creativity inside you, you can have, you know, ideas, imagination, but you need the tools to know. Can you be a carpenter? I could put together a table, I could do that, and it could be a functional table, it will possibly break after 3 days. But if I learn how to really make a table, I will make a very solid, beautiful table. Chances are my beautiful table will still not be very beautiful to anybody else because I'm not a carpenter. You know, one of my things that I always wanted to do was work on a clay, make a pot from a wheel, a potter's wheel. And my mother never really sent me to class or anywhere. She didn't, I don't know why. When I was 18, I started working in a blind school in Bombay, doing theater with them, and they taught me how to make a pot on a wheel. But my pot was always like that. Which was great because they could always recognize, oh, yes, Sanjna didi ka pot hai. Because they were blind, they could feel my. But I could never center it, you know. So whether you're going to be good at it or not, you don't know. But you need the tools and you need to figure that out. But in the arts, the tools are twofold. In the arts, there's the technique. And that's all the arts, huh? That's painting, that's writing, that's theater, that's poetry, music, whatever. There's a technique. So you can be a great singer, but what are you going to sing? So you have to feel yourself, which is this and this and your whatever soul, with learning, with life, with experience, with wisdom. So knowledge is not an end in itself. You know that, you must all know this beautiful saying which says, knowledge tells you that tomato is a fruit, but it is unwise to put a tomato in a fruit salad. So, that's the difference, and you need to figure that out. Yeah.
My name is Rao. My question is that, do we really have a single passion? Is it not necessary?
You can have
many. More than one.
Sure. Yeah, you can have many passions. And it's good to keep them, you know, but try and, you know, figure out what you can do when, you might go mad if you've got too many, but you can have more than one passion. Yeah. And you might have them at different varying levels. I know that for me, the ocean is very important. I'm from Mumbai. And I grew up with the sea. So I'm not even Delhi right now, so every now and then I'm like, I need the ocean. So I have to go to the ocean. I'm sure you feel the same about the mountains. But that's not my primary, you know, but I need it. I need it for my sanity. But, and as I said, I'm very passionate also about education, but it's not my primary passion. Sometimes circumstances will also tell you what you have to go for more seriously than others. Like I just told my husband the other day, I said, if I didn't have Junoon, which is my baby that I co-founded with my colleague, Samira, I said, I would work only with children in theater. That's all I would do. Grown-ups are very complicated. So I love working with children. And that would just give me the greatest joy. But I also love Junoon. I do love it. Yes.
And what do you think about NSB?
I don't think about NSB. But if you're forcing me to think about NSB.
But
You know, in India, sit now. In India now there are more. So, I mean, this is shocking. We are how many? 1.3 billion people in this incredible rich fabric of cultural magnificence, and we have one MS. We have now some Tripura mein or a branch there, South India mein ek aur branch hai. Universities mein drama seriously ho rahe abhi kafi. In a lot of universities they have drama courses. In Kerala, Chandigarh, I mean, but a lot more. So Bombay mein bhi hai. But there's nothing that I would say, and there are some one or two training places where you can go for training, workshops and things. But I would not say that there are some, and there is anything that I can say, wow, this is terrific. If you wanted to be in theater, I would say there are must go to short workshops, short courses across the country. You must go and find a theater person who you love his or her work and become their partner. And just watch them. Sometimes it's a very boring process, but doesn't matter, just be bored, but imbibe everything you can from watching them, experiencing them. So NSD for me is a highly over everything. It's a lot of our taxpayers' money spent for very few people. I don't think it's a good boast to say ki hamare itne sare bachche Bollywood mein hai. So I would love to be able to say that there have been positives. Regionally, Hindi belt wale bahut kam hai, I think, from NSC Telecom, and actually germinated many things. But in regional languages, South India, Manipur, Tripura, Bahut, there are Assam, there are NSC students who have gone and done a lot of good work. But yeah, I don't
think. Yes. I'm really passionate about writing. I like to check how people live their life, and I think people watch television most read both, but I think where we are living is also in most house. And how they are living their life. I love the idea of observe people, and I'm very much into writing to put my words into the life of people and how they are living is my passion to create and storytelling to people.
And you do that.
Yes.
And are you getting people to read your work?
Ma'am, I did want to open my shows, and there I put my
artistic story. Oh, you spoke your stories. But published?
No, I'm not.
But you can, and you should. And now there are so many opportunities in internet where, you know, it's so beautiful. Sit. So it's...
In which language do you do that?
English.
I love the idea of words. How the infectious energy the words have, and how we can influence and motivate people to our work.
Absolutely. It's huge. That's wonderful. You know, there's so many, but the thing is, really, really go for it. We were in Bhutan at the literature festival, my husband and me. And my husband is not, he doesn't read much literature. He reads a lot of factual stuff. And poetry, kuch nahi. He might have done it before I met him, but he doesn't. It's very boring when it comes to all that. But, so we were watching, and we had gone to listen to somebody, a next speaker. So, Jaldi Ponce, and we happened to watch a lovely, a beautiful young, she's 26-year-old American girl whose name is Sarah Kay. Google her. She's a spoken word poetry is a unique new type of poetry in itself. And she was standing on stage speaking and performing her poetry, and my husband's mouth fell open. Like this, not only because she was beautiful, she was very beautiful. But he went, and he's not a man to say many kind things. He's very grumpy. He's, yeah, I'm painting a very horrible picture. So he went up to her. He went up to Sarah after the performance. And he said, "You paralyzed me with your passion." Oh my God. And her words, which were talking about her teacher at school, they were not, you know, they were just very personal, everyday things that she was talking about, but the manner in which she used words was so magical that it moved somebody like my husband, which is a phenomenal thing. So it's I think, really powerful. And you must find more and more ways to reach people. So that's the other thing, is that actually the arts are... So yesterday somebody was saying to me, last night, he was saying to me, you know, we all, people, theatre, we all know ki theatre wale theatre kyun karte hai, kyunki unka hi junoon hai, it's their own chaska they get out of doing theatre, you know, and they should do it. And I said, no, sorry, that is one part of why we do theatre, okay? Because we can do that in our rehearsal room and not show anybody. Or we can do it in front of our family and get baba. But we do it in front of strangers and we know how to touch them. We know to move them. You know the magic of words. You know that you make that difference. And it is that live connect that is why it is important. Either it's live or somebody reads your work or they see you on YouTube. It's important. It is what makes a society rich. And we have to go out, walk about with that confidence to say we matter. It's not only our own little apne liye hamara ye hai. It's not. It's we matter in society today. If we had a society without any arts, it would be gareeb and it would be violent. It would be very violent. It would be so violent you wouldn't even know what to see. And that's why we need to make sure that we have the arts in every part of our society in India. And I'm saying this very, very clearly. For me, I hold theatre and the arts as important as education, clean air, clean water, good roads, electricity, medical facilities. It is the same. You know, log kehte roti kapda makan ha. Ab jab electricity le aaoge na, government. So you better make sure that kala is there. You know, don't erase that. Because kala se we make meaning and we can understand the world. And we can come to understand what's going on. Unfortunately, the kala has been replaced with religion. And that can be problematic. You need religion, yeah. Your own personal thing. Yeah. But as society, we need kala. Yeah. Yeah. Now go and digest all that and do something about it. Okay, that's enough. Thank you.
And creating a such a positive environment. Someone like Selfie said that he learns by doing, and learning has no boundaries. Now, so the show must go on. Moving ahead, now I would like to welcome Ms. Twinkle and Mr. Shivam to have a brief interview section with such a cheerful personality.
Oh my God, really? Yeah. Oh my God, that's why you were not asking questions.
They are from the Information and Broadcast Forum. So have a such a
See, you can't see us, right? Get my chairs, right? Yeah. Oh, Sam.
No, sit down.
Don't ask me the same question.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
I'm Shivam. Yeah. I'm Shivam Pugaliya. Along with Twinkle, we are from Information Broadcasting Forum. And ma'am, firstly, I would like to compliment you, ma'am. You're so beautiful, ma'am. So, ma'am, with permission of yours, we'd like to start this issue.
Ma'am, you've been working with
the
theater since you were 10. Ma'am, what theater actually? What is the...
All the well, actually, because theater for me is a life choice. It's a lifestyle. It's not a job. It's not something 9 to 5 you go and do and you come back home and you do something else. So I grew up in that mahal and I was very lucky and fortunate. When Prithvi Theatre was being made, I was 9 and 10. And I remember my mother with the architect, and on the dining table, the architecture blueprints, the plans. And I remember looking at it and saying, oh my God, this is like a puzzle. That is the staircase, that is the stairs, that is the bathroom. And I love that. And so I am fascinated with architecture. I love architecture. And I love architects because I think architects, if they're good, also are philosophers. They have to be, if they're good. Because they have to know how a human being finds comfort in a space. They have to build the walls around that, right? So I think that is just life experience that I was exposed to. So for me, theater was all that experience. My grandfather, Jeffrey Kendall, had, when he came to India, he would stand for me. I'm a performer, I need to be seen. So I'm not a performer anymore, but I was. So my grandfather, when he came to India with his theater company, my mother was 13. So by the way, this is part of my family inheritance. My mother was 13. My grandfather had gone to her principal in England in the Lake District and said, can I take Jennifer out of school for 1 year and bring her back? Will you keep her place? And the teacher said, why? And he said, because we're going to India and we don't want to leave her behind. And the principal said, of course, what better education, take her. My mother left and never went back to school. She's the most educated person I've ever known. And my grandfather went to England with my mother and their 8-month-old other daughter, second daughter, Felicity. And when she grew up in India. So she was in India till she was 18. And then she went to England. And today she's still an actress in England, a very, very, very well-known actress in England. But in India, there was a big fight between my grandparents saying we should send her to school. My grandmother said she should go to school. We're traveling theatre company. They were nomads. They were gypsies. But still, they could go to school. And my grandfather said, no, what nonsense. Why does she need to school? You will teach her how to read and write. I'll teach her mathematics or whatever. What else does she want? She's getting educated. She's reading Shakespeare. She's reading Bernard Shaw. She's reading Noel Coward. She's reading the greatest classics in the world. Why does she need to go to school? Luckily or unluckily, my grandmother won that battle. And she did go to school. In fact, she went to about 12 schools. And she was very proud as a little girl because unka khud ka dabba tha costumes ka. And unka costume ka dabba mein uniforms, school uniforms se. And she was very proud of that. So, what was your question? Where am I going?
What is theater?
So, theater is alive, yeah. Theater is alive.
Ma'am, how was your experience hosting the Amul India show that took for 3.5 years now?
I auditioned for that. It was before that I was earning money in theater is difficult. Very difficult. So it's changing in big cities now. People are managing to. You have to be an entrepreneur. You have to be a supreme entrepreneur in theater. So I used to do voiceovers. I used to do. There was another sports show that used to come out of Doordarshan. I used to do voiceovers, photo photo workshops. I used to earn a little money, and. When I got this offer to come and by somebody who interviewed me for NDTV for the festival, Prithvi Festival, and she said, do you want to come for an audition? So I auditioned here and I was very nervous and I thought, by chance, they take care. And I didn't know what to do, you know, cut a camera or whatever. And I got it. And it was the easiest, most wonderful job. I didn't have to use my brain. I was given a script that was written by somebody else. I had to wear beautiful clothes and makeup and my and 2 hours of work a week, and I got paid really well. So I could do all the theatre I wanted. I could go and do school diving. I could go to Africa. I could do everything. It was fantastic. I feared two things. I feared interviewing people, and because I had to then do homework.
and then I had to, and I'm not an interviewer, you know, so I'm not good at asking a question for which I know the answer. Like, why am I asking? I don't know how to do that. Please, I'm not a journalist, but it's not in my, so I would try, it was very difficult. And it was also difficult to be me. I like acting as another person, so I had to be me. And I was like, I don't want to be me. Anyway, so I can be me now, and I'm older and wiser, but then I had to be me in front of everybody in their living room, and it was not easy. And the most difficult part was my father. Because he would critique me every Sunday. It was a Sunday morning show, and he would watch it religiously, and he would critique me. And usually, I mean, he was kind, but he would say, makeup was all wrong, your costume was terrible, your breathing was all wrong, you know, what were you doing? And then one day I got to interview somebody called Balmik Thakur, who had just released, Land of the Tiger, a wildlife series on BBC, and it was because of that I got into it. And the message came to the producer, ki, she can interview me, but in Delhi, and I was from Bombay. But she, could she have dinner with me? Me too, to one in house. So I said, okay, I'll have dinner with you. But I was interested in him because I always wanted to go to the jungle. When I was 10, I had an opportunity to go to the jungle with my two closest friends who happened to be boys. But my father suddenly said, no. Boys ke zara mere sabse daste. Are my closest friends? I stay with them all the time. What difference is it? So he stopped me from going to Nepal to the jungle and seeing a tiger. And I never forgave him. So then I went and interviewed Pali Papa. And I was very nervous. I saw his films, I read some of his books, and I asked friends, what should I ask him? And it was a good interview, it was cheek tack. I met him for dinner, another friend of his was there, Naam ki waste, Khetrawala. Very boring dinner tha. He was so dark, and he was this dark. Pessimistic, gloomy, dark, negative, the world is coming to an end. Politicians kuch nahi karenge, bureaucracy ka nahi, hamare tiger sare marenge, arre bhai. Horrible. So I left. My father next week, he saw this interview and he called me up and said, you're in love with this man. Are you mad? Are you crazy? He's just on his own. My brother a few months later said, Balmik Thakur, I've been seeing it. He's your kind of man. I'm like, what? You're not mad. So he's my husband. So so Balmik actually comes from a journalist family. In fact, his father, it's a well-known fact, Romesh Thapar, fought the government for a Freedom of Speech Act in Madras many, many years ago. So if you look at Romesh Thapar, Google it. And his case will come up as one of the first freedom of speech cases in independent India. He started something called Seminar in 1980. So Balmik also has written over 40 books, right? So I come from this very intimidating family of not only cinema on one side, but all these journalists and brilliant minds on the other. And people are asked to write one article a month. So I would write, but it was a struggle. And as you know, I'm not educated. In a formal sense of the word. So I haven't gone through any formal processes of knowing how to formulate your thoughts and put them down in a cohesive way, right? So I haven't gone through that. And I had a wonderful opportunity. The Week magazine asked me to write for a celebrity column, for which they were paying me a lot of money, so it was great. My journalist friends are horrified. They're like, that's criminal. You should be paying that. That's not fair. But every 2 weeks I had to write an article, 750 words about my world of the arts, and it had to be on time because it had to be published. I did this for 4 years, and it was the greatest challenge of my life. Unfortunately, I thought when they said, "Acha bas ho gaya, thank you so much," I said, "Theek hai, I will continue because wo discipline aa gaya maine mein ki I know ki Thursday ko I have to," and then everywhere I'm going, I'm thinking of ideas, and I said, "I will continue this because it was such a good
have it to be personal. It doesn't matter if it's published. In a diary, we need. I haven't written anything. It's terrible. And it's, so one has to find motivation. And I wish I could, actually.
Ma'am, being a child, everyone has different dreams. Like Twinkle was to become astronaut.
Okay.
Mine was to become an actor as a child. That's it. So, ma'am, was there any such with you, or it was theater?
I wanted to be a trapeze artist in a circus. I really did, and I wanted to be a farmer. I wanted because my mother used to tell me stories of. When she was little in England, the Second World War was going on, and they would have to work on the farms also, and she would go work potatoes, you know, and she would be picking the potatoes, and the big thresher would come, and how excellent she had, and how difficult it was. And I just thought, I guess, you know, to grow something with your own hands that you then benefit from, I think, is a magical thing. I think that every child's education in India should be that 1 year of your school life, you should be learning in a positive way. You know, Rabindranath Tagore has written about it, Gandhi has written about it. How do we create an India which is connected to our urban rural connect? And we don't know anything about that. We don't know anything to connect the two. And I think that that is what is really important, that we make that connection. If you know, if you're not interested, you should go, okay? Because you don't need to chit chat at the back, guys. I'm not tackling you, I'm just asking you to be quiet. So, Sabina and I have worked for 10 years together at Prithvi Theatre. And the one thing that I think is the biggest poverty, the biggest challenge in theatre is not money. Money to hai nahi, to wo to theek hai, hum to karte rehte. Money will always be a challenge and that you have to find. But I think the biggest challenge really is to find the right people who will do the work that I do, which is not the glamorous work on stage performing, but it's the management work at the back end work. And I used to always say this, and Samira would always argue with me, saying I'm wrong. And she will prove me right. And I'm saying, the day you prove me right, I will be the happiest person on earth. So that she's still, it's an ongoing thing. So now we run Junoon and we have people working with us. But it's still a challenge. We still a challenge to find people. But we worked together for 10 years, and I think our ambitions grew. We wanted to move from this, and I think I did everything I could possibly do within my scenario. And I couldn't challenge myself anymore. And I needed the next step. And the next step was to go out there and create something new and to start joining the dots across the country. And it's a huge dream. We're going to do a drop. We're going to achieve a drop in the ocean. And that's okay. But that's why we've taken it on. And it's a very exciting journey. And actually, what was surprising to me is the number of people that wrote back to me when I announced that I was, and I wrote letters out saying that I'm really pretty and I'm starting to know, and the amount of, my God, amount of love and respect and generosity that people gave me, it was wonderful. I didn't understand why, but I think it's just that people recognize and appreciate when you go out there and take a risk, you know, something completely. And I think that was a lovely safety net that suddenly came around us.
Ma'am, we have heard that you love traveling. So, which has been your favorite place till date?
You know, I was just thinking that, I'll tell you, so my son, who's 16 now, 3 years ago he asked me quite a dangerous question. Dangerous because it was like unexpected for me. So, he's traveled a lot. He's a very well traveled person, a lot in a certain amount in India, but a lot abroad. Wildlife places, but also Europe a little bit. We've met friends in Russia, and you know, yeah. So he's a very well-traveled person, and I know that his. Unfortunately, he's grown up in Delhi, which is really sad. Nobody should grow up in Delhi,
it should be banned. He asked me, he said, Mom, will you be very sad if I decide to go live abroad? And he was like, oh my God, this is a moment of, you know, children always do that, they catch you off guard. And I said, oh, I have to say something very clever and very smart, and I have to also not break his aspirations or dreams or whatever he wants to do. And he doesn't have to do what I want. So I said, no, you have to live where you're going to be happy. And I really wanted to say, please stay in India because I love India. And why do you want to work abroad? But I couldn't say anything. So I said, well, and he knows that. But I said, well, I would be sad if you stop knowing India. And that will take a lifetime. So give whatever you want. You know, continue to grow. So this year, I have been really fortunate, personally, to travel so much. I've traveled from Bikaner, I've just come back from Calcutta. I went to Hampi, which is just amazing, in Karnataka, near Vijayanagar. It's the Vijayanagar dynasty, 150 years of the most extraordinary, rich kingdom that is now left in ruins, and it's extraordinary what you experience there. And so I'm going to Kochi next week. I'm going to Sindhudurg before that. I mean, I'm traveling a lot in India, so I love traveling in India. But Africa and the wilds of Africa, something very special to me as well because of Bombay. So there's one particular place we go to in the Serengeti. Serengeti is very big. We've traveled quite a lot in Africa. I have always missed, in the first few years we used to travel as tourists, and I hate that. I'm really bad. I'm a very grumpy tourist because I like meeting people. I like connecting to real human beings. Also, you know, animals are nice, but only so much. And then we were lucky because my husband recognized this in me, so we got to meet real people in Kenya and in various places, and that was wonderful. But there is this place in the Serengeti called Nameri, and there is a place in Nameri called Gol, which it's very difficult to explain. It's very difficult to describe. You feel the ancient primitiveness of land and the animals and the relationship between land, animals and nature. And for me, I don't like only seeing animals, right? I'm very lucky, I see a lot of animals. So it's not like I'm ticking them off on my bucket list. I like seeing behavior. Like I like seeing human behavior. I like seeing animal behavior. That is what is interesting to me. So you see relationships between, and so we stay a long time. We stay 10 days in one place. So we go back and see the same leopard family, the same lions, the same, you know, cheetahs. And then you see them, have it. It's really amazing. It's like a NatWest or whatever, National Geographic program, and you get to see it live. It's a blessing. You feel blessed that nature allows you. I love scuba diving also. So when you go scuba diving and you see, and I dive with my son now, and when you see fish, and there again, you see them, and there's so little known about the behavior of there, and you see their relationships with people, and they come up to you. They're curious. And it's just
fantastic.
So right now the government has a very Maiba way of dealing with grants. inheritance, you know, we come from this wonderful feudal inheritance. So it is, I patronize Katnam, so I will give you my largesse, I will give you my grant. That is the attitude across state governments, mostly across state governments, but definitely from the central. We are a few federal setup, so it's quite different from state to state. But I think that the government needs to explore, and that's something I'm working on in my own imagination, is three things. They need to nurture. And what does that mean? When you nurture the earth, you make sure the manure is right, you make sure there's enough oxygen, you make sure that it will be a good kid, right?
you need to foster, so you need to make sure that when the plant starts growing, that it has all the right ingredients, manure, whatever, keep the insects away, make the environment, nurture the environment and foster the environment so that this plant can grow, and you need to enable. So then you need to enable this, whatever you're growing, to become a forest or to become something huge and wonderful, and the roots to go deep and strong. So if the government were to shift from this patronage mindset and become a nurturer, a fosterer and an enabler, I think that there would be a huge development in our arts. We have the arts, we have a huge variety and richness, but we don't have the infrastructure. I think so. I think for our character.
The biggest struggle.
So I guess the biggest struggle was to decide to make Prithvi. Because you know, yeah, you're nurturing something for 21 years and you hope that it can blossom beyond you. I have failed. In my mind, with Prithvi, because I wanted to create an institution that would live beyond me and the family. And that will not be. Because it hasn't been set up. I mean, it may be, somebody else may set it up, but I don't think so at the moment. So that is my that was a big struggle. It was not a struggle to create Junoon. I mean, then one you know, that was a great excitement, great challenge. I mean, struggle at Prithvi also was the isolation, and then what you had mentioned, you know, the sense of isolation, and therefore it gave birth to a lot of connections and networks, which is what I did. I think the biggest struggle, was for me to learn how to ask for help. So I think for me to ask, at Prithvi I was not very, I could go and ask for sponsorship and I learned how to do that. I didn't know how to do that. I had to learn by trial and error. But sponsorship was easy, na? Because paisa vasool. You give me money, I'll give you this. That was easy. But for me to be able to ask you to give me money because of this dream, I didn't know how to do that because my dream was very internal. It was my dream. And I didn't think it mattered to anybody else. And that was a big mistake because it does matter. And so for me, in Junoon, there was a huge learning and a huge liberation from that. Almost, I felt a little burdened by 50 speaking. Perception, yeah, okay. It's a public charge of trust. It should be not so, but what the perception is, and so that was a burden. That was tough. My father, yeah, he didn't allow me to. I mean, my father was wonderful. He didn't stop me. But being a woman, I actually am very fortunate. I have never really. I don't think I've faced anything overtly different from if I was a man. I know I can use my charm, but then something about it. If I can be charming, so but I'm not blind to the fact that there is human inequality. I'm learning to be conscious of it, more and more conscious of it. And I think that we're living in very interesting times right now. We're living in times which are forcing us to be conscious of a whole lot of things. A lot of differences. And the differences that we took for granted for many, many years. Whether it is male, female, power differences, caste differences, whatever. We are being forced today to address them, to look at them, to recognize them, and to know what we want, what is our position vis-a-vis them. And I think it's really exciting. It's a really good time for that. Because it's provoking conversation, it's provoking contemplation. And I hope we'll then provoke change. Yeah, don't wear these pants.
Because I'm walking here and I see all these women trying to be men.
Is that because we have to become like them? Well, go through this and you'll evolve. Hopefully one day you'll find your own form of dress, which is something that we all want. Just be conscious of it. You know, I'll tell you one last thing, okay? Because this is a bruising moment story. We were at one point doing workshops, corporate workshops, which I don't do anymore because I actually can't. We can't. It's too different a world. But they wanted us in an IT company to come in. IT company based in Chennai. And they do a lot of, they create software for American companies. And so their employees are a lot of women, a lot of them are women. And they have to talk on Skype to their American clients. And the IT company wanted us to come to the theater workshop to change their beautiful women who wear flowers in their hair and their teacups and their power women, you know, like South Indian ladies. They wanted to make them look more acceptable to the American. That's a problem. I want to know why the American can't be acceptable to us. We have to know who we are. So all I say is, even when you're dressed like that, know who you are. Know where you belong. Know what is makes you you. And you don't have to be anybody else. You don't have to be American. So it's...